Go ahead. When I point, just introduce yourself and about time and year and some background.
Okay. Nora gave me quite a lot of questions. If I ask half of them, this would be too long. Well, I'm John Baker. I was born in Grand Blanc in a big old farmhouse that was 11 foot tall, the rooms were. I was born in the what we called the summer bedroom because it didn't have any heat. They did have a fireplace here. We had two fireplaces. I weighed 10 pounds when I was born, and the doctor charged $10 for bringing me into the world. So he must have done it by the pound. Let's go back and talk about our inheritance, I guess, or the parents, grandparents. My mother's side was May, and they are direct descendants of Hugh Campbell, who was the first Duke of Argyll. And they came over he was on the wrong side of the uprising in England when Cromwell came in to power, and they cut off Charles the first head, and along with my Hugh Campbell, or the Duke of Argyll. So they both got in trouble there at the very beginning. You can see they decided that he was all right after a while because they brought his son back in power, Charles II and the second Duke of Argyll. The Duke is buried in Westminster Abbey. I've been there. If you're ever in England, go through the Westminster Abbey, look up Hugh Campbell, the first Duke of Argyll. He'd probably be glad to see you. On my dad's side, they were more outlaws. He was a farmer and a foreman of a ditch outfit, ditching crew. His brother was already over here in Flint, and he decided he wanted to come over. They sold everything and were waiting for the ship to leave. He and a buddy were out at night poaching rabbits, and he got caught, and they hit him over the head with a codger, they called it. And he got back to the house, they put some flour on, and they left town in the middle of the night with five kids and everything they had. They went to Plymouth. They had to stay there about 30 days before the ship sailed, and then they came over here to Flint. He was one of 13 kids. Or no, he had 13 kids, and the oldest one was my grandfather. I started talking about my great-grandfather. My grandfather was named Charles too, and he was in the Civil War, got along good. He's a little guy, he joined when he was 14, but he was a messenger, and he was with Sherman. They got along good. The fall of Atlanta, everything was going good. They had a little battle called Stony Mountain just east of Atlanta, and he got captured there. They shot his horse, and he ended up the last 8 months of the Civil War in the Andersonville prison. He only weighed 80 pounds when he came out. But he ended up raising 7 kids after he got out. And he bought the house where I was born, the house that was made in 1830. Let's see. After Dad came along, he was the oldest. Dad didn't get married till he was 42, and he was nearly 50 before I came around. And it was during the Depression, things were rough, but I had awful good parents. They took real good care of us with what we had. When I was 16, we sold the old farm, didn't get much out of it, and we rented a farm for 3 years. That over by Holly, and while we were there, Dad died leaving. I was 16, my brother was just 18, two sisters and a mother. We it was rough, but Herb and I got along real good, my brother Herb, and all the neighbors couldn't believe how well we got along. But anyway, that's where Nora wanted me to tell some of the stories I used to tell her, so I'll tell how we called my brother, my dumb brother Herb. He had three things, I'll tell three different things. One, we had three good-looking neighbor girls would come over at night when we were milking, and they'd bring their bucket, and we'd sell them some milk. And that was going along real good till Herb told them one day, they went to pour milk out of a bucket, and he said, "Don't take it out of that bucket yet. We've got to strain it over again. The dog peed in it." And that ended those good-looking girls coming over to buy milk from us. They never bought any more milk. Another time, we had a swamp right next to the barn. They're not very far on the road. And in the spring, a lot of people would get stuck. And we'd drive down, take our tractor down, pull them out for a dollar. One day, some guys were stuck down there. And Herb and I went down, and he backed up to the car and told the guy, "You got a dollar?" And the guy said, "No, I'm not going to pay any dollars." So that we stood around, watched them dig themselves out. They finally got out. And when they got out, Herb said to me, hollered up to me, he said, "John, we got to dig that hole deeper." And he was always getting me in trouble that way. Then when we moved from there to go to, we only lived there 3 years. When we moved to go to Bancroft, all the neighbors came around and helped us move. And that night, first night we were at Bancroft, Herb said, "Gee, that was nice, all those neighbors coming around." I said, "Yeah, but you want to remember, they were all fathers of girls you've been messing around with. That's why they helped move us." Well, after Herb got married, we farmed there for a few years. After Herb got married, I saw there wasn't going to be room for two of us, so I went to Michigan State College in the winter term of 1946. I didn't have any money. I had two jobs there. I lived above the barns. I found that you could have one meal a day with pancakes during a term. I lost 20 pounds in college, but I lived above the barns, took care of the cattle, the experimental cattle, and the experimental lambs. One day, I had a date with Jane, and one Sunday evening afternoon, and I was in a hurry to feed the stuff. And two women came along, and they were in my way all the time, wanting to ask why I did this, why I did that. And one old cow there at night, in the evening, we only gave her straw. When I gave her straw, they said, "How come that one just got straw?" I said, "I don't like that son of a bitch. It kicked me once." So they left, and I imagine they had quite a lot to say about how the livestock was taken care of at Michigan State University. Our sophomore year, I knew Jane before I went to college, but Jane and I started dating the sophomore year. First date was to the football game. I tell everybody she had a free ticket, so I took her there. But we dated for all the three years. We went to, she joined the sorority house, Alpha Gamma, or no, she, Zeta Tau Alpha, and I joined the farmhouse fraternity. We had a lot of formal parties. It cost $15 to rent a tux, and I found one for sale, used one for $15. So we went to a lot of the big bands, Jimmy Dorsey and all those. We had a good time in college for 3 years. We went through there. When we graduated, we came up here to Alma. Jane had a job teaching at $2,400 a year. $2,400 a year. and I had a job as a 4-H youth agent at 3000. I got off to a great start. They said if you start now, 1st of June, you'll be in for a raise the 1st of July. So I started there, and I worked 4 days, and then we graduated, and then we got married the next day on the 6th of June, and then we took a week honeymoon, came back and worked 2 weeks, and they gave me a 12% raise, which was $400, which was big then. But we rented an apartment for about a year, just a little better, and raised enough money that we could make a down payment on a house down on David Street here in St. Louis. And so that's the only time we rented. We lived there 9 years, and then Jeff came along, and we built this house up here, and we've been here ever since. We have a nice home, and we're real happy with it. We had the 2 boys. We lost Jim this summer. That was a rough thing to take, but life goes on. I'm blessed with 5 of the best grandkids in the world, and I know they're all going to do real well. I could go on forever, but that got to there. Here, how much further do you want?
No. Oh my God, they're right here, aren't they? Oh, you put corn out too.
Yeah.
This was the bouquet that I got. This bouquet.
Oh, seriously? I don't remember them from the wedding.
Hmm.
I shot a wedding that they were at, and they watched me work. And that's why she asked me to do this, as it came out. She said I did a really nice job, so I felt pretty good. I was pretty honored. Uh-huh. So it came down to it. I think what I'm going to do is put this on the couch. I'm going to take a shot of this, if you don't mind. Mm. Actually, no, I might be able to.
Okay, I was a 4-H agent for 3.5 years, and I was the first 4-H agent here. They had 300 kids when I came. They had 86 country schools. I visited them all twice. And in 3.5 years, I had them up to 2,700 kids in 4-H. Some of the things I did that I'm kind of proud of. One was moving the fairgrounds from the Gratiot County Fair from Ithaca. They were fighting over there before I came here. They had 2 fairs. So the second year I was here, I moved a fair over to Alma. We have a great fair. We've got great facilities there, and I'm real proud of the fair over there. The crew that's working on it now are doing a wonderful job with it. I started Rainbow Lake. I bought a bunch of land there, and I was pasturing cattle, and it came to me that you could make a lake out of it. And I started buying up more land there. I only paid $43 an acre for the land. Wow. And most of it, I was buying it on a land contract or an option. And I tried to raise money to build a dam there. And I found out real quick it was hard to raise money. Everybody was interested, but they didn't have, none of them that I knew had very much. So I sold it. And the people that built the dam and the lake lost a lot of money on it, but it's a good lake. And the Fulton school system wouldn't be there today if it wasn't for Rainbow Lake. The taxes from Rainbow Lake supports that school. I got into a rainmaking project. That was an interesting thing. Some of the farmers wanted, we had 2 years of real dry weather, and they wanted, Dow Chemical was fooling around with weather modification. They quit because of public relations, really. And so I took a sabbatical for a month and looked up all I could on weather modification. checked with Massachusetts Institute of Technology. They said Michigan be the easiest place in the country to get more water by seeding the clouds. So I took the kids and Jane, we drove out to Boulder, Colorado, talked to the head of NOAA that was in charge of weather modification. He showed me a shotgun shell that they took the BBs out and put silver nitrate in it. And he said, we go up in the airplane, we shoot out of the window and it makes it rain. Boy, that's when I found out you better have faith if you're going to get involved in a weather modification project. But he said, just like the guy in the people in Massachusetts Institute, that Michigan was would be a real easy place to get rain. So we went on out to Palm Springs, California, talked to the head, to a guy named Ivan Crick. He said he'd come and do it for $100,000 for three counties. He wanted to do it for 5 years. And I told him we'd try to raise the money for 5 years. Wouldn't guarantee we could have it for 5 years. So we came back, told the farmers, and they raised $100,000. And it's hard to get money out of farmers. And every farmer that paid in knew that the next door neighbor, if he didn't pay in, he'd get the same amount of rain. So, but we raised the money, and we raised it for 5 years. Now, there was all kinds of comics in the paper. It kept the paper going real good for 5 years. Some people thought they got way too much rain. Very few people thought it didn't work. The biggest kick was they got too much rain. We ran it for 5 years, and by that time it started raining a lot more, and we haven't used it yet since then, but it was an interesting thing. We had real good farmers in Gratiot County. I started out plowing with a team of horses that plowed 12-inch furrow. We expanded to 14-inch and put another horse on, and then we could plow an acre and a half. When we were farming out here, we had a 12-bottom plow. Each of them plowed a foot and a half, so we were plowing 18 feet, and you didn't have to stop the tractor like you had to with the horses. But I enjoyed being the county agent here. I've got a great lot of friends that still know me, and I wouldn't do it. I really enjoyed the job.
How old is Nora?
Nora's 25.
Okay. And that's the bouquet.
Mm-hmm.
Got it. Just gonna get about 10 seconds of that shot. Now, where does she live?
Nora?
Yeah.
Down there. She and Nick lives in
Alma?
No, they live down at Burr Oak.
Oh, okay. So they're a ways away.
Yeah.
I like the small town. We live way out in Wynn by the gun club, out in the sticks.
In Wynn.
I teach in Shepherd.
Yeah, good. Okay, when I was in college, right at college, I knew Jane. She worked for an ice cream store, dipping ice cream. And I knew her there. I never dated her. I'm 90 years old, or almost. There was 86 kids graduating my class, and as far as I know, I'm the only one left, and I guess I sometimes wonder why I'm still around. But a lot of it is because of Jane. She takes good care of me. I try to take good care of her. And there's no better wife in the world than what I have. And the grandkids really worship Jane, and I think that's great. We had a lot of fun in college, and I would, kids go to college, a lot of them don't meet anyone there, and they're missing something, and they don't Dayton College, and I'd highly recommend it. We're in fair health, both of us, but we're going to stick it out as long as we can. Guess I'm running out of things to say.
When you proposed, how did you
propose? When we proposed is the question. Really, it comes natural, I guess. I wouldn't say we ever did propose. She says we did. They have a stone at Michigan State where you're supposed to sit when you propose, but we knew we were going to get married long before we sat on that stone. But that's all right. It comes gradually, I think. Today, when 50% of the marriages are break up, they're making an awful mistake in breaking up, because you live a long while and you need them all the way through. Yeah. But I think I'm very fortunate to have the kids and Jane.
What is why did Mom didn't like you? Why?
I don't know. She was a bitch. I don't want to get into that.
No, I won't have to put that in. Don't worry. That's good.
We did get married again on the ship, on a cruise about 10 years ago. That was a nice wedding. We had a couple friends stood up with us. And
where was the cruise?
I don't remember where we went. We go on a cruise about every year. We didn't go this year.
Gotcha. Sticks out in your mind.
Well, I remember when when Lucky Lindbergh flew across the ocean.
Really?
I was only 4, but I remember it.
Wow.
I think the biggest event was landing on the moon. I think God, that still seems impossible they did that.
I can't think of the year. I'm trying to remember the year. I was born in 64.
Yeah.
It was in the 60s, if I'm not mistaken, when we landed.
What's that?
Wasn't it in the 60s?
Yeah, I think so.
Differences between today, growing up today, like for kids, as opposed to when you were growing up. What are the differences you see?
Well, there's a lot of difference. The difference between growing up now and then, of course, number one, you didn't have television. Our home, I had the best parents in the world, but no one had any money. At Christmas one year, we had 6 oranges. And there was 5 kids, and Dad and Mother split an orange. Everybody's got so much now compared to then. But we didn't think we were poor because everybody else was the same way. Television is the big thing now that kids are wrapped up in. I think the fact that kids have got the computers now is they're going to do so many things. People worry about these kids aren't going to amount to much. These kids are going to go a long ways. They've all, my gosh, when a kid is 6 years old, he can run a computer. And we got a great granddaughter, that's Sydney. And she's a pride and joy. She's only 2 months old, but We like her, and she'll be running one of those in another 4 or 5 years probably. And I don't have one. If I was born 10 years early, I would have. Don't have any use for one. The reason we came up here was the county extension director, the guy above me, was getting old, and it was one of the best counties in the state.
That's okay, go ahead.
Had the best soil, and he was, I figured he'd only be around about 3 or 4 years, and I was right. He got the job, and I quit being 4-H agent and did. That's why we came up here. And the people, I had the theory that the better the land, the smarter the people. That smart people, farmers got on good land. And I guess that's why we came up here. Oh, I know that's why we came up here.
Highest honor or award you ever received?
Well, yeah, I could tell a little bit about college life, about ROTC and that kind of stuff, you want, and what we did there. I can get in that.
Go right ahead.
You get that ready?
Oh yeah, it's going.
Going now? All right. Well, when I was in college, everybody had to take ROTC, every boy, and we had to pray. And after I prayed for 2 or 3 weeks, I figured I'd learned all the important things about prating. And I found out that if you could make the rifle team, you didn't have to parade. So I went down and tried out for the rifle team. And they had all the sharpshooters back from the war. And there's a lot of competition. But I made that and I as a freshman. And I was second man on the team. We shot against Texas A&M. West Point and a whole lot of schools. We did real well. The reason I was such a good shot, I think, was when we were kids, we had to shoot pheasants year-round in order to eat. And we did shoot them year-round. There's a lot of pheasants, and we didn't know the difference between a hen and a rooster. They all tasted the same. But I was on the judging team. I was real active in college. That's why they gave me this county, too. But anyway, I was on the livestock judging team. We judged cattle as far away as Texas. And got to all the Big Ten ag schools practicing judging. I was on the active and junior farm bureau. And the other job I had in school was in the public relations department. They only allowed you to work 20 hours in school, so I signed my name out in the barns, John W. Baker, there on campus in the public relations department. I was just John Baker, John W. and John, so I could get 2 paychecks out of there. So they only paid $43 an hour, 43 cents an hour, but it added up. And so I had 2 jobs all the way up through school. I was able to buy Jane her diamond ring that I made while I was in school. The best awards I've got, I think, are the farmers that come to me today and tell me that I did them a lot of good. And I'm real proud of that. And I get that quite often.
And what, is there anything you do differently?
I'm real proud of my grandkids, and we've got great ones, and of course I'm real proud of Jane. She's done me a lot of good.
Would you do anything differently?
Anything different that I'd do? No, I don't think so. I may not farm when I retired. I retired early. I was director of a bank. I might have gotten to banking a little bit, but I wanted to farm, and you do what you want to do.
You get many turkeys here. There's turkeys down below. They don't come up here much.
I had 42
yeah.
in a space like this, just fighting over the corn.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my dogs were going nuts.
If they come this time of year, you're going to have a lot of them.
That's so nice. Just sit here by the fire watching the deer. I would be in heaven right here.
You lost 3.
Boy, you're feeding them well. That one on the right's solid.
No, we don't feed them very much. Corn's too high priced.
Yeah, I noticed that the other day. I think it was 50 pounds for about $9.
Yeah.
Did John tell you we have possums that come up here at night?
No.
Yeah, we've had three or four possums. They come in here after dark, climb up there, and eat out of there.
Really? What advice would you give to kids today?
Get as much education as you can and learn to work. A lot of kids don't know how to work. But, boy, they're missing a boat if they don't get education today. Because it's an educated world they're going into. Well, I'll tell you a real proud part Jane and I had. When Nora got married, we had a big reception. And when it came time to throw the bouquet, Nora came over and Nick gave Jane the bouquet, mm-hmm. and got a hold of me, said, "You got to come up and give a talk and tell us what advice." Now, I was real proud of my grandkids then, and you got to make it mind what you're going to say. Just short, it was a surprise to me, and I told them that my dad and Nora's great grandfather were 42 before he got married, and most of the bakers didn't marry till they're about 25 or 8. But once a baker got married, most of them stayed together. And I said, we bakers have kind of a model: never go out for hamburger when you got steak at home. And I guess I was as proud that night as I've ever been. Mm-hmm. I guess when Nora brought that bouquet to Jane, because that doesn't happen very often.
And this is kind of along the lines, you might have already answered it. I'll read you the whole question she wrote. Do you have a philosophy about life? What's the best piece of advice you give for living? Like if a young person came today, is there anything you could add?
I don't think we could say anything that hasn't been said.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking along that line. I think we've touched on almost all of them.
Caught on that. No. You want to know when we got, you got that on?
Yeah.
Turn it off. I want to